Well, good evening. We are glad you are with us here tonight for our Sunday evening service here at First Baptist Chatsworth. You know, we serve a great God and we serve a mighty God. And as Pastor Mark is going through the book of Revelations with us, we're longing for that day when we stand in heaven and we just worship him and praise him together. We want you to worship with us tonight as we sing. Sing along with us right at home where you're watching online. Let's sing together Agnus Dei.
Alleluia. Alleluia. For the Lord God Almighty reigns. Alleluia. God Almighty reigns. Alleluia. Holy, holy are you, Lord God Almighty. Worthy is the Lamb.
Revelations, we see where it says we will stand around his throne and we will sing holy, holy, holy praise to the Lord God Almighty. Let's continue to praise him tonight as we sing together Revelation song.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Holy, holy. Sing a new song to him who sits on heaven's mercy seat.
Sing that again.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Holy, holy is he. a new song to him who sits on heaven's mercy seat.
Lift it now, holy, holy.
Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you.
Sing with me, clothed in rainbows.
Clothed in rainbows of living color, flashes of lightning, rolls of thunder. Blessing and honor, strength and glory and power be to you, the only wise King.
Now lift it.
Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you. Awestruck wonder at the mention of your name. Jesus, your name is power, breath, and living water, such a marvelous mystery. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you.
Amen. Thank you, Pastor Mark.
Good evening, and we want to thank you for taking the time to tune in to our Facebook Live and to our YouTube station here at Chatsworth First Baptist. Appreciate Gary so much leading us in worship, and we're excited to be going through the only book in the Bible where there is a specific blessing that is promised to all of those who read and hear the words of the prophecy of the book of Revelation. So as you go with us through this book, just know that God's promise to you and to me is blessings. I don't know exactly what those blessings entail and how God chooses to do that, but I just know that His word has been given to us, and He is a God that cannot lie. He is neither the Son of Man that He should lie, neither man that He should lie, nor the Son of Man that He should repent, as the scriptures say. So turn with me in Revelation chapter number 6, and we're going to begin reading in verse number 9. And we're going to do a little bit of an overview tonight and catch us up on some things. And I think you'll enjoy just settling in and understanding a little bit more of what we've already read. So let's begin in verse number 9. And when he had opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of them that were slain for the word of God and for the testimony which they held. And they cried with a loud voice, saying, How long, O Lord, holy and true, dost thou not judge and avenge our blood on them that dwell on the earth. And white robes were given unto every one of them. And it was said unto them that they should rest yet for a little season, and their fellow servants also, and their brethren that should be killed as they were should be fulfilled. Beginning in Revelation chapter number 6, we are brought face to face with God's vengeance. This is a 7-year period known as the time of tribulation. As a matter of fact, we're going to study a little bit tonight in Matthew chapter number 24, and I'm going to parallel that with what is called the first half of the tribulation in Matthew chapter number 24, verses 1 all the way down through verse number 15, with the first four horsemen in Revelation chapter number 6 that we have studied last week, to try to give you a little bit more of an overview of the chronology of this tribulation period. Beginning in Revelation 6, as we're brought face to face with that vengeance and this 7-year period of time known as the tribulation, it is also called the time of Jacob's trouble. That's with reference to the nation of Israel, and you'll find this in the Old Testament. As we study through the book of Revelation, we'll dive into the Old Testament passages that really have already predicted the coming of what we're going to be studying in the book of Revelation. In other words, really John is writing about the fulfillment and the fruition, although he's writing in the future, and it's still prophecy, of what Jeremiah and Isaiah and Amos and Zechariah and many of the Old Testament prophets have predicted before time. So the tribulation, as Jesus speaks of, or the great tribulation, as we'll see in a minute, that Jesus speaks of, is also known in the Bible as the time of Jacob's trouble, and that's in specific reference to the nation of Israel. Jesus in Matthew 24 preached a sermon we call the Olivet Discourse, or the Sermon on the Mount of Olives, in which he discusses this 7-year period of time, and he says it will be divided into two halves. The first half is called the beginning of birth pains, and the second half is called the great tribulation period. One is found in Matthew 24:15. We'll see these verses a little bit later on our PowerPoint. And the other is found, I believe, in Matthew chapter 24 and verse number 1. And it is interesting to understand why it is that Jesus would be going into such detail in the Olivet Discourse, or the Sermon on the Mount of Olives in Matthew 24, to discuss this end of time, period of time, known as the tribulation and the great tribulation. The first half, as I just mentioned, would be called the beginning of birth pains. It's a very vivid term. Prior to the birth of a child, there are a series of birth pains that become increasingly more intense and closer together the nearer of the birth of that particular child. So those birth pains begin, and they're not that strong, and they're kind of in long periods of time. It may be 10 minutes, 5 minutes, 8 minutes, 12 minutes, whatever it may be. But the closer to the birth of that child, the more intense the pain becomes, and the shorter in length of time those birth pains are. Jesus is saying the great event of the arrival of the King of Kings, not a child, but the arrival of Jesus Christ coming in all of his glory and power, will be preceded by birth pains. They will start slowly, will be far apart, but will become more frequent and more intense in pain in the last 3.5 years, which is called the Great Tribulation period. Why does he go into this? Matthew 24:3, on the Mount of Olives, the scripture says, as he sat upon the Mount of Olives, that's Jesus, the disciples came unto him privately saying, "Tell us, when shall be these things? And what shall be the sign of thy coming and of the end of the world?" So specifically, the disciples asked the Lord Jesus Christ, "What is going to be the sign of your return? And what is going to be the sign of the end of the world?" Because they realize the scripture teaches that when Jesus Christ comes, at some point, the world is going to be rolled up like a scroll. Well, Jesus answers this. And let me say this to you. It's very important. I want you to look at me for a second. What Jesus says in the Olivet Discourse in Matthew 24 perfectly parallels what you see in the tribulation and in the great tribulation, that period of time known as 7 years, called the tribulation period. And then it split in half, and the last 3.5 years, that it is called the great tribulation. So notice how Jesus answers them. And Jesus answered and said unto them, now, this is what's going to be the sign of my coming and of the end of the world. Take heed that no man deceive you. For many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. This is the pouring out of God's judgment, as we've talked about beginning in Revelation chapter number 6, beginning in verses 1 and 2, the first seal that is open of that seven seal scroll of Jesus taking back the earth, and the first horse is a white horse with someone coming. We have determined and we've seen in Scripture last time how it was the Antichrist, and he ushers in a time of peace. Revelation 6:1, and I saw when the Lamb opened one of the seals, and I heard, as it were, the noise of thunder and the four beasts saying, come and see. And I saw, and behold, a white horse, and he that sat on him had a bow, and a crown was given to him. And he went forth conquering and to conquer. He had a bow but no arrow. We looked last time at how when the Antichrist comes at the beginning of this 7 year period, according to Daniel chapter number 9 and verse number 27, he's going to come and make a covenant for a 7 year period of time. In other words, there's going to be a 7 year period of time. He's going to sign a peace treaty with the nation of Israel. He's going to bring peace to the Middle East. The world will be settled because most of the turmoil that has taken place in our world over the last number of years has centered around the conflict with Israel and the Palestinian area, that problem area in the Middle East. So the Antichrist is going to come and he's going to bring peace to that. So Matthew 24 and Revelation 6 speaks of a deception and a false peace. And in Revelation 6, it speaks of the Antichrist coming, and he is coming deceiving, he's coming flattering, he's coming easing in, not with power and might, but with flatteries of words. Notice what Jesus says next. For many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. And ye shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that ye be not troubled, for all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. For nation shall rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. Now this is the second seal. This is the second horse that we studied last week. It's the red horse of war, and it is a time of war. Jesus speaks of that in Matthew 24, 5 through 7. He says there'll be wars, there'll be rumors of wars. Nations are going to rise against nations and kingdom against kingdom. So the Antichrist comes in with a peace treaty, but before long, trouble begins to arise. In Revelation 6, 3 and 4, he says this, and when he had opened the second seal, I heard the second beast say, come and see. And there went out another horse that was red, and power was given to him that sat thereon to take peace from the earth, that they should kill one another. And there was given unto him a great sword. In other words, a time of war on the earth. So Matthew 24:7, nation will rise against nation, kingdom against kingdom. You see paralleled in Revelation 6 with a red horse in a time of war. Look at the next one. In Matthew 24:7, Jesus continues and he says, for nation shall not just rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom, but the end of verse number 7 says, and there shall be famines. This is the third seal that came. It was a time of famine. In Revelation 6, 5 and 6 says, and when he had opened the third seal, I heard the third beast say, come and see, and I beheld in a black horse, and he that sat on him had a pair of balances in his hands. And I heard a voice in the midst of four beasts say, a measure of wheat for a penny, and three measures of barley for a penny, and see thou hurt not the oil and the wine. In other words, these are famine conditions. A man would go out and all day long he would work and he would get a penny. And he would get just enough food to feed one person for that entire day. And a measure of barley for a penny. That was what the poor would eat. And he'd only be able to get three measures of barley for a penny, and it wasn't enough to feed an entire family. And they had to make a decision on who was going to be fed. These are famine conditions. And see thy hurt not the oil and the wine. This is showing a separation between the very wealthy and the very poor. There's no middle class that's going to take place in that tribulation period. And oh, we'll see that even come more vivid, and why that is so important, and the persecution and the problems that it's going to bring the further along we go through the book of Revelation. Matthew 24, 7 and 8, notice he uses that word famines. And then in Revelation 6, he speaks of famines. Read with me, if you would, there again in Revelation 5 and 6, where he says a measure of wheat for a penny and three measures of barley for a penny. These are famine conditions. Now, after the famine and after the war comes the next horse, which is pale. It's literally a pale greenish color. It's a horse would look extremely sick, and something would be bothering this horse. Jesus, in his chronological order that parallels Revelation 6, speaks of the same thing of death. He says, for nation shall rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be famines and pestilence. That's all kinds of disease. Now think about this. Here we have the last year and a half just dealt with COVID. And all of a sudden, a disease springs up, and there is something that we have no cure for. It is some type of infection. It's a pestilence that literally sweeps the globe. That's what he's talking about. And boy, if that should ever be vivid on our mind, there will not just be a pestilence. There will be pestilences. Possibly it will come from some type of chemical warfare that's taking place when the nations and the kingdoms begin to fight against one another. And he says there are going to be earthquakes. Of course, we know of earthquakes and how devastating they can be, and the masses of people that they're able to kill. He said, and they're going to be in diverse places. They're going to be at all kinds of different locations. He says, all of these are the beginning of sorrows, the beginning of birth pains. So everything we have studied up to this point is in the first 3.5 years of the tribulation period. Now, that fourth seal is a time of death. And of course, it parallels what Jesus has said. He said, and when he had opened the fourth seal, I heard the voice of the fourth beast saying, come and see. And I looked and behold, a pale horse. And the name that sat on him was death and hell, following him with him. And power was given unto them over a fourth part of the earth to kill with sword and with hunger, that's famine, and death, and with all the beasts of the earth. In other words, one quarter of the earth. That would be billions of people at this point, and over a billion people would die right now on earth if this were to take place, with wars, with famines, with death, and beasts of the earth. And that little word beast of the earth is in the Greek language is not a large beast, but even just a small rodent like a rat, and all of the disease that they can bring into the life or into society and into a civilization and a community. Interesting. But what is he saying? He's saying, I want you to know there's going to be deception by the Antichrist, a false peace. Then there's going to be wars that will spring up. There'll be famines that will come. And then there's going to be death in the grave. One fourth of the earth's population is going to be extinguished in a very short period of time. In Matthew 24:8, Jesus said, all these are but the beginning of the birth pains, or the beginning of sorrows. Well, he goes on in Matthew 24:21, just a few verses later, he says, then there shall be great tribulation, such as not been from the beginning of the world until now, no, and never will be. Here we see Christ dividing the 7-year period, the first half called the beginning of birth pains, and the second half called the great tribulation. The second half of the tribulation, or what is called by Christ the great tribulation, is a 3.5-year period, and it is identified as such throughout the book of Revelation. You'll notice these terms all through the book of Revelation. 42 months, 1,263 days, a time which is equal to 1 year, a times which is equal to 2 years, and a half a time which is equal to half a year, and all of that equals 3.5 years of the last half of what we know as the tribulation period. It's also identified in Daniel chapter number 12 and in verse number 11, but Daniel adds 30 more days, 1,290 days. You say, Brother Mark, why does he do that? We believe he's given room for the cleanup after the Battle of Armageddon and for the commemorating of Jesus Christ becoming the King, being crowned the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, and being honored by all the nations of the earth, and a coronation that will surpass all coronations that have ever been on the face of the earth. The event that will begin the Great Tribulation. Now listen to this. The event that will begin that last half of that tribulation period. So remember, 3.5 years into that 7-year tribulation, there will be an event. It is when the Antichrist sets up an image of himself in the temple the Jewish people have built for worship. And he will demand the world to come and worship him as Christ. Of course, he's the false Christ. He is the antithesis of the true Christ. And this is called in the Bible the abomination of desolation. All right? Matthew 24:15. When ye therefore shall see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet, stand in the holy place. Whosoever reads, let him understand. Now, right here, in Matthew 24:11, he spoke about what? The beginning of birth pains. Right here in Matthew 24:15, he says, when you see the abomination of desolation spoken by Daniel the prophet, stand in the holy place. He says, I want you to know, if you're on the rooftop and you're in Jerusalem, don't come down. Get out of the city. They oftentimes would run from rooftop to rooftop. He said, if you're out in the field, don't come back into the city. He says, woe to you if you be with child. He said, it's going to be a time of great tribulation that the world has never seen. And the beginning marker of that great tribulation period is when the Antichrist sets up an image of himself and demands the world to be worshipped. Here it is in Daniel 9:27. Daniel says, and he shall confirm the covenant with many for 1 week. That's 7 years. Here the Antichrist sets up a covenant for a 7-year period. And in the middle of that week, at that 3.5 year period, he shall cause the sacrifice and oblation that was in the temple. You say, what is the sacrifice and oblation? Well, it was where the children of Israel in the temple period in the Old Testament, they would offer up sacrifices and they would offer a morning and evening oblation, worship and honor to God in the morning and evening. He makes all that stop. And then he sets up an image of himself to be worshipped. And it desecrates the temple. Daniel 12:11, Daniel also speaks of this. He says, and from the time that the daily sacrifice shall be taken away, and the abomination that makes desolate set up, there shall be 1,290 days. That's that extra 30 days from the 1,260 I just mentioned. What is that, Brother Mark? That is the last part of the tribulation period known as the Great Tribulation. Daniel and Jesus Christ both identify that event as the beginning of the last 3.5 year period before Jesus Christ returns. You say, well, what do you think? Why is Jesus doing this? Because the disciples ask him. The disciples said, hey, Jesus, what is going to be the sign of your coming and of the end of the world? And let me tell you this, from that moment of the great of the abomination of desolation is when you begin to see the birth pains intensify. All of a sudden the sun turns to blood, or the sun is darkened, the moon turns to blood, the stars begin to fall. There's all kinds of curses and judgments that are poured out upon the earth in an unprecedented fashion, and they take place in a very rapid succession. Now the question arises, where do we see this event in Scripture? Is it prophesied, the abomination of desolation? The event that is prophesied by Daniel and Jesus, do we see it ever unfolded before us? We see it in Revelation 13. It gives a detailed account of the events leading up to the abomination of desolation and of that event itself. As a matter of fact, I'll give you a little preview before we get there. There is a person by the name of the false prophet. He will be literally a world religious leader. He will set up an image of the Antichrist in the Holy of Holies, in that temple. He will demand that the world come and worship him. And if the world does not, whoever does not worship him, and whoever does not take the Antichrist mark of 666, he'll be martyred. He'll be killed. This brings us to the fifth seal. This is why we've gone through all of this. After this fourth seal, there will be widespread persecution of those who have believed. Now, I want you to listen to this. I think this is extremely important for you and for me to understand. Matthew 24, Jesus is continuing his chronological order of this tribulation period. And remember, we're not to Matthew 24, 15 yet, where the abomination of desolation is taking place. So we're still at the end of the first 3.5 year tribulation period. And Jesus says they'll deliver you up to be afflicted and shall kill you, and you shall be hated of all nations for my name's sake. And then shall many be offended and shall betray one another and shall hate one another, and many false prophets shall arise and shall deceive many, and because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax old. You say, Brother Mark, what is that talking about? I want you to look at me. He's talking about martyrdom. There will be people that will be saved during that first half of the tribulation period. There'll be people that'll be saved after that first half, during the great tribulation period. You say, well, how will they be saved? Well, there'll be people who are listening to messages like this, I believe, that have been left on the internet, that have been left on CDs, that have been left on DVDs. I believe they'll begin to read in Daniel and Revelation and Zechariah, and I believe the Holy Spirit will give clear evidence. As a matter of fact, the Bible says that at this point, the gospel of the kingdom would be preached all over the world. How will that happen? Well, there'll be 144,000 witnesses. We're going to see them in Revelation 7. And there'll be two witnesses. And they'll have power that they won't be able to be killed. And then there'll be an angel that will go through and preach the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ so that the entire world will hear and people will turn to faith in Christ. And the Antichrist and the false prophet and the religious and the government system will be married. They will not allow that to take place because the Antichrist is going to be he is going to demand to be worshipped as God, and there will be a systematic killing of believers all through the end of that first half of the tribulation, and it will flow over into the great tribulation. This is prophesied all over the place in the Bible. Mark 13, 6 or 9 through 13. Take heed to yourselves, for they shall deliver you up to councils, and in synagogues ye shall be beaten, and you shall be brought before rulers and kings for my sake, for a testimony against them. And the gospel must first be published among all nations. And it will be. It'll be published by the 144,000 witnesses, by the two witnesses, by the angel. But when they shall lead you and deliver you up, take no thought beforehand what you shall speak, neither do you premeditate, but whatsoever shall be given you in that hour, that speak, for it is not yet ye that speak with the Holy Ghost. Now the brother shall betray the brother to death. This is apostasy. There'll be people that will be a part of groups of believers, and they will betray one another. They'll get fearful of losing their life, and so they'll give up some who are believers. And ye shall be hated of all men for my name's sake, but he that shall endure unto the end shall be saved. Listen to Revelation 17, 6. It tells you how bad it'll be in the great tribulation period. He says, and I saw the woman drunken with the blood of the saints. The woman is the false church that the Antichrist and the false prophet will set up. And he says, this woman is going to be drunk. She's going to have killed so many people who have followed Jesus. She is pictured as being drunk with the blood of martyrs, the martyrs of Jesus Christ. Matthew 24, 13, but he that shall endure unto the end, the same shall be saved. And listen here, and this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations, and then shall the end come. There he has it. He says the gospel is going to be preached. 144,000 virgin Jews, 12,000 from every nation, two witnesses, an angel. You'll see it in Revelation as we study through it. And then the fifth seal is open, and all of a sudden there's a prayer for vengeance. You say, what and who is involved in this prayer? Who are the people involved? Look at it, Revelation 6:9. And we opened the fifth seal. I saw under the altar the souls of them that were slain for the word of God and for the testimony which they held. In other words, all of these people who have been martyred by the Antichrist and the false church, the false prophet, all of these people who have died during the tribulation and the great tribulation period, they are underneath. So this fifth seal, listen, chronologically, it begins in that first half of the tribulation, but it overflows past the abomination of desolation, and it even enters into that second half of the great tribulation. And here they are, they're underneath the altar, which is a picture of the altar of incense, and their prayers are arising into the presence of God. And what are they praying? These are the ones who have lost their life. Later on it says they were beheaded for the testimony of Jesus Christ and for the word of God. They behead them. They kill them in every way you could even imagine. And these are the martyrs during the tribulation period. Matthew 24 and Revelation 6, it parallels perfectly with what Jesus taught would happen at the end of the age. In Matthew 24:9, then shall they deliver you up to be afflicted and shall kill you, and you'll be hated of all nations for my name's sake. I've already mentioned the apostates being revealed. They shall betray one another. False prophets shall arise and deceive many. Who are the false prophets? Well, it is going to be the ultimate false prophet and all of his disciples and cronies that will go out into the world and proclaim that the Antichrist is the true Christ and come and worship him. Interesting. The people that are involved are the believers during the tribulation and great tribulation. The petition that they cried with a loud voice and they asked God this, how long, O Lord, holy and true, dost thou not judge and avenge? They want vengeance, our blood, on them that dwell on the earth. Well, here's the promise that God affirms to them. He had given them white robes, every one of them. You'll see them in Revelation 7. When we get to Revelation 7, there is a multitude of men and women of saints that cannot be numbered. They're clothed in white robes. They have palm branches in their hand, and they're worshiping Jesus Christ. And John looks at an angel and says, who are these? And he says, these are they who have come out of great tribulation, and they have been killed for the word of God and for the testimony of the Lord Jesus Christ. And they're robed in white robes. Jesus gave them to them, a picture of the imputed righteousness of Jesus Christ. And it was said unto them that they should rest for a little while, just for a season. God says, listen, I want all of you that are praying, I want you to just rest. Be easy, you've entered into your rest until your fellow servants that are still in this tribulation, that are still in the great tribulation, until their brethren and that should be killed as they were should be fulfilled. In other words, there are going to be more of you that are going to be killed that are on the earth. I want you to rest until all of this that I know in my omniscience and in my foreknowledge, until the last soul that's going to be beheaded, until the last soul that's going to be killed in this great tribulation period, until they're dead. And then, listen, whenever this begins to take place, I'm going to begin to pour it out. Often the scripture speaks of the vengeance of God. He says, for the day of vengeance is in mine heart. In Isaiah 63:4, he said, I have trodden the winepress alone, and of the people there was none with me, for I will tread them in mine anger and trample them in my fury, and their blood shall be sprinkled upon my garment, and I will stain all my raiment. Listen to me. This is the answer to the prayer of those saints that are praying underneath the altar. They are praying in accordance with the will of God, because God has always said throughout the scripture there would be a time where he would pour his wrath and his vengeance out upon the earth. Micah 5 and verse number 15, and I will execute vengeance and anger and fury upon the heathen such as they have not heard. We're going to see that as we study through this book. Isaiah 59:17, for he put on righteousness as a breastplate and a helmet of salvation upon his head, and he put on the garments of vengeance for clothing and was clad with a zeal as a cloak. He is coming with a zealous vengeance on those who have cursed and blasphemed and worshiped the Antichrist and have rejected him. Paul speaks about it in 2 Thessalonians 1. He's saying, seeing it is a righteous thing with God to recompense tribulation to them that trouble you, and to you who are troubled, rest with us. The same exact words that God says to them. I want you to rest when the Lord Jesus shall be revealed from heaven with his mighty angels in flaming fire. Listen to this. Taking vengeance on them that know not God and that obey not the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. I'm telling you, the prayers of those martyred saints have been prophesied. They have been pictured. And someday God in heaven will fulfill the promise that he has given to them. And it's even spoken to in the New Testament. Who shall be punished with everlasting destruction? Paul goes on and says, from the presence of the Lord, from the glory of his power. You say, Brother Mark, do you rejoice in this? No, we're with John. I've mentioned this verse to you before. John chapter number 10, verses 8 and 9, he says, the voice which I heard from heaven spake unto me again and said, go and take the little book. That's the scroll with seven seals, which is opened in the hand of the angel which standeth upon the sea and upon the earth. And I went unto the angel and said unto him, give me the little book. I want you to give me that seven seal scroll. And he said unto me, take and eat, and it shall make thy belly bitter, and it shall be in thy mouth sweet as honey. You say, why, Brother Mark? Well, because finally Christ is being honored. The word of God is being completely fulfilled. All of the prophecies of the Old and of the New Testament, and even in the book of Revelation, is coming to pass. And Jesus Christ is going to take his rightful place. But look at the outpouring of the judgment and the vengeance of God. There is none of us that want to see that. As a matter of fact, the scripture says of the person of God that vengeance and judgment is his strange work. But it is his work. You can't just have a God that is just loving and kind and have the God of the Bible. Because the God of the Bible reveals the Lamb who will become the Lion of the tribe of Judah and the Root of David, who will pour out his judgments upon those who have hated and who have rejected and who have killed his children as surely as they killed his son. And he is going to fulfill the promises and the prayers of the Word of God and of those saints that are going to be underneath the altar in Revelation 6. Next week, we'll see that sixth seal and that seventh seal opened and see how it is that God begins to pour out his vengeance upon the earth. Thank you so much for being with us. You be praying for me, and I'll be praying for you.